A very good evening, friends. Dr. Anuradha Dhawan here. Wish you all a Merry Christmas and wish you a time full of health, happiness, and success. So today we are going to discuss a topic, nystagmus, and I'll try in this session to make the nystagmus easy for you. Okay. So welcome once again to this special YouTube session, Nystagmus Made Easy. I'm Dr. Anuradha Dhawan welcoming you to this session. Okay, friends, so let's start with the session. So we are going to discuss about nystagmus. So what do we understand by nystagmus? Now, nystagmus is a type of involuntary movements of the eye. Okay, now these involuntary movements are characterized by their regularity, that they are regular, they are rhythmic and oscillatory in character. Okay, so these are the movements like you can akin to a pendulum or any type of a regular rhythmic oscillatory movement. Okay, that is what is your nystagmus is known as. Okay, now when we are talking about nystagmus, so first of all, it can be classified in different ways. The types, the first one which we are going to discuss is regarding what is the character of the movement. Okay, so you can divide by that it into two types. One is your jerk type movement or pendular type movement. Now, pendular type movement, like a pendulum. Okay, pendulum goes to or from one end to the another end, comes back to the similar end, and then again the movement is repeated. Okay, a pendulum like movement. In this pendulum-like movement, the both the phases from one end to the another and the return phase, they have equal velocity. Okay, they have equal velocity as we have depicted it here also. So both the phases or both the movements, they have equal velocity. So this type of the nystagmus is known as pendular nystagmus. The second type is that the movement can be like jerk. Okay, there is a slow movement, and then there is a fast recovery, then there is another slow movement and a fast recovery. So this makes the nystagmoid movement jerky. So this type of the movement will be jerk nystagmus. So it will have a slow component and a fast component. Okay, so slow component is usually the defoveating motion. Okay, so what is happening actually in nystagmus, the eye is moving away from the fixation point, so defoveating movement, and then it comes back by the fast component for the refoveation. So fast component is for your refoveation. Okay, so what is the nature of the movement? By that we can divide nystagmus into jerk, in which there is a slow component and a fast component, or pendular, in which both the components, they have the equal velocity. Now, when it is jerk type of nystagmus, the direction of the nystagmus is guided by the fast component. Direction is in the fast phase. Okay, so if the movement, the fast movement of the eye is towards right, so it will be right sided nystagmus, or so on. Okay, then we can also characterize nystagmus by that in which direction the eyeballs are moving, whether it is horizontal, vertical, or rotatory. Okay, so in the horizontal nystagmus, the eyeballs, they will be moving right, left, okay. In vertical, they'll be moving up and down, okay. And in rotatory, they'll be showing the rotational or torsional movement. Okay, so your nystagmus can be horizontal, vertical, rotatory, or even mix of these movements. So this is according to the direction of the movement. Okay, then your nystagmus can again be manifest and or latent. Okay, so in squint also we study that the squint can be manifest or latent. Similarly, nystagmus can also be manifest or latent. Manifest, that it is present all the times. Latent means it is hidden at certain times. And usually it becomes manifest when you break the fusion. Okay, when you break the fusion, then the nystagmus becomes apparent or manifest. Okay, then your nystagmus can be conjugate or disconjugate. That is, it is similar in both eyes or it is dissimilar in the two eyes. Okay, that can also be the type of the nystagmus present. Now, by etiologically, if we etiologically divide the nystagmus, then according to the etiology, nystagmus can be physiological, which is normal, seen in normal people, or it can be pathological due to some disease process. Okay, we'll be discussing about it further. And then from the onset, it can be divided into that whether it is congenital or infantile, present since birth or in first year of life, or acquired later on. Okay, so onset can be congenital or acquired. So this is how we characterize or we the nystagmus according to, let's have a revision once again. Whether it is a pendular type of nystagmus or jerk nystagmus. The jerk nystagmus will have a fast phase and slow phase, and the direction of the nystagmus is guided by the fast phase, the fast movement. Okay. Then whether it is horizontal, vertical, rotational or mixed type. Then whether it is apparent all the time, that is manifest, or it is apparent only on breaking the fusion, that is your latent type. Okay, whether it is similar or dissimilar in both the eyes, etiologically, whether it is physiological or due to some disease process, and onset, whether it is congenital or acquired. Okay, now first of all, let us discuss the physiological nystagmus. Yes, there is physiological nystagmus, the nystagmus which is seen in normal people in normal conditions. Okay, it is not necessary that the nystagmus is a pathological feature only. So there are three types of nystagmus which are normal or physiological. Number one is your optokinetic nystagmus. Okay, so you must be familiar with the word optokinetic. Optokinetic drum is used for assessing visual acuity in children also. Okay, so this type of the nystagmus is seen in normal people, the people who have normal visual acuity. Okay, and why this type of nystagmus occurs? Now in this, what has happened, this drum which you are seeing in this image is known as optokinetic drum. Okay, so this is your OK drum or optokinetic drum. Now, as you see, it has vertical stripes, black and white. Okay. Now, when we rotate this kind of drum, so the stripes, they appear to be moving. Okay. So you can rotate it vertically or you can rotate it horizontally also. Okay. And if the person who is observing this moving drum, if the person has normal vision or if the person has normal fixation, there should be onset of optokinetic nystagmus in that person. Okay. The person with normal visual acuity or with functional visual acuity, on seeing this rotating OK drum, should have onset of optokinetic nystagmus. Why does it happen? Because see, when you are looking at a moving object, there are two type of the eye movements will happen. Okay. One are your pursue movements. When you are looking at a moving object, there are pursue movements to follow the moving object. Okay. And then there are jerk movements or saccadic movement to refixate. When you are looking at a moving target, you have to refixate. So that saccadic movement occurs. Now the pursue movements will lead to the slow phase of the movement, and then from one stripe, you are following that, and then your eyes will refocus by a jerky movement to the next coming stripe. Okay. It's very easy to understand it by imagining that if you are sitting in a moving train and you are looking outside and there is another train passing. So you'll see the coaches of that train are passing. So your eyes are following a particular coach till some time, and then it refixates to the next coach which is coming. So that leads to a physiological nystagmus, what is known as optokinetic nystagmus. It is a physiological nystagmus. Okay. Rather, this principle is used to check the vision in pre-verbal children, because the children, very small pre-verbal children, we use this objective test. It is an objective phenomena to check the vision. This also helps us to differentiate malingerers. Okay, because if a person is feigning blindness, and if you rotate this drum, the eyes will automatically go into optokinetic nystagmus, and that false assumption of the malingerer, you can disprove that. Okay, right? Then second type of your physiological nystagmus is what is known as end gaze nystagmus. Okay, now in extreme of gazes, whether it is extreme right gaze, extreme left gaze, extreme up gaze, extreme down gaze, there will be very fine nystagmus even in normal individuals. Okay, so end gaze nystagmus is again physiological. The third type of your physiological nystagmus is what is known as vestibulo-ocular nystagmus, which is the basis of your vestibulo-ocular reflex. Okay, here what are we doing? We are stimulating the tympanic membrane. How? Either we can use the cold water or we can use the warm water. Okay, so if we put the cold water in one eye, okay, then there is a jerk nystagmus. This type of the nystagmus is a jerk nystagmus. A jerk nystagmus will develop with this, with its fast phase towards the opposite side. Okay, so on putting cold water, C stands for cold water, there is an onset of nystagmus on opposite side. Okay, and if you put warm water, there is an onset of the nystagmus on the same side. Okay, so this can be remembered by a very simple mnemonic, cows, that when you are putting warm water, the jerk nystagmus which is induced is on opposite side. When you are putting cold water, it is on opposite side. When you are putting warm water, it is on same side. So this is again a normal physiological phenomena. This forms the basis of your caloric test also, if you remember what is done in the ENT. Okay, now after these physiological conditions, we will now come to the pathological nystagmus, okay, which is not normal. Now our eye movements are under the control of your sensory visual pathway, the integrity of which is essential to maintain normal vision and the normal fixation. Then also on the vestibular pathway, along with the function of the semicircular canals, and the midbrain and the cerebellum. Okay, so these three pathways or these three parts are important. If there is disturbance in any of these, sensory disturbance or motor disturbance, that can lead to the onset of pathological nystagmus. Okay, so what type of the pathological nystagmus they can be there? So they can be, as we according to the onset, they can be congenital or they can be acquired. Okay, or congenital oblique infantile. Okay, that is in the early childhood. Okay, so first of all, we'll be discussing the childhood nystagmus, out of which your most important one is infantile nystagmus syndrome. So as the name is suggesting, this is seen in children, infantile nystagmus syndrome. Now, before we discuss what type it is, try to understand what can be the cause. Okay, now it can be both idiopathic, that it is not necessarily associated with poor vision. Okay, or it can be due to sensory deprivation, that is due to poor vision. Okay, so we can understand that if a child has poor vision, especially in the age group when the fixation reflex is not developed, fixation reflex starts at 6 weeks development. So if there is any disease which is obstructing the sensory stimulation for the fixation reflex, that will lead to the development of nystagmus, because the fixation, the foveal fixation, is not developing. Okay, so the causes of poor vision in childhood can be the diseases like oculocutaneous albinism, okay, and iridia, Leber's congenital amaurosis, bilateral optic nerve hypoplasia, rod monochromatism, or any disease. For example, it can be congenital macular scar due to congenital toxoplasmosis. So any disease which is present since birth or in early childhood, which is leading to sensory deprivation, can lead to nystagmus. Or it can be idiopathic. Idiopathic means there is no association found. There may be relatively good visual acuity, but still the child has nystagmus. Okay. Now, what kind of nystagmus it is? Mostly it is pandular, especially when it is associated with sensory deprivation. Okay, when it is associated with sensory deprivation, it is pandular in nature, though it is irregular. The waveform keeps changing. It is not a very regular type of the nystagmus, and it can convert from pandular to jerk type. So these are the features. Okay, then the child has a null point or a neutral zone, you can say, in which there is relatively good visual acuity and the amplitude of the nystagmus is least. Okay, a null point is there, such a position of the eyeballs that at which the nystagmus is minimal and fixation or visual acuity is good. Okay, so the child assumes a head posture. The child assumes a head posture in that position only which is within the null zone, so that nystagmus is minimal and good vision can be obtained. And oscillopsia. Okay, what is oscillopsia? Now, if you develop acquired nystagmus, especially in adults, it will be your eyes will be moving involuntarily, and the things which are or the objects which are around you, you will feel them moving. That is oscillopsia, that the objects will also be seen as moving. Okay, so which will be very confusing and disturbing to the patient. In congenital or infantile nystagmus, this oscillopsia is not felt by the child. The parents will notice that the eyeballs of the child are moving, but child himself is not feeling that the objects around him are moving. So that is known as oscillopsia, which is absent in congenital or infantile nystagmus syndrome. Okay, so what happens in this type of nystagmus decreases and increases with certain factors. Now, it increases with fixation. If the child will attempt fixation, the amplitude of the nystagmus will increase. Okay, the amplitude of the nystagmus decreases on induced convergence. If you ask the child to move the eyeballs inwards, again bringing a target closer to the child, or when the child sleeps or closes the eyelids, and with the use of the contact lenses. So these are the three conditions in which the amplitude of the nystagmus decreases, whereas it increases with fixation. Okay, so how we will treat the infantile nystagmus syndrome? So as it decreases with contact lenses, you can provide contact lenses to the patient. You can give prisms. Okay, and then there are surgical corrections also. The two important procedures are your Kestenbaum procedure, in which we insert the recti or the muscles like that the eye remains in null position. Okay, so that the nystagmus is minimal. Or we do recession of all the recti, so that the movement of the eyeballs which are happening, the nystagmus, the amplitude of that again decreases. So this is the principle of the surgery in case of nystagmus. Okay, so this was about your infantile nystagmus syndrome. So please make a concept, infantile or congenital. It can be idiopathic or any cause of sensory deprivation since birth or in early childhood. Okay, mixed type of nystagmus, starting as pandular, can become jerky. There is a null zone, so the head posture is assumed to keep the eyeballs in that null zone where nystagmus is minimal, and the child does not experiences oscillopsia. Okay, this type of nystagmus increases with attempted fixation, when you are trying to fix at a particular object. Decreases with convergence, decreases with sleep, also decreases with contact lenses. Okay, and these things are used for the treatment: prisms, contact lenses, or surgical correction. Okay, fine. So can we go ahead? Okay, the other type of your childhood nystagmus is what is known as latent or latent manifest nystagmus. This is another childhood nystagmus. Okay, So here, you remember, we talk about latent squint and manifest squint. Latent squint is the one which comes when you cover or one eye, or when you break the fusion of two eyes. So similar is the happening in the case of this type of nystagmus also. So here you see, as you are seeing in this picture here, when both the eyes are seeing, there is no nystagmus. But when you cover one eye, the uncovered eye goes into the nystagmus. Okay. So nystagmus is becoming manifest when you are covering one eye. Okay. With monocular viewing. When binocular viewing, it is latent. It is hidden. Okay. And this type of nystagmus is a jerk nystagmus, as you can see here. And the fast phase is towards uncovered eye. So you see, this side is the fast phase and this side, the other side is the slow phase. So this is your latent manifest nystagmus. The point to be remembered by this, for this nystagmus, it decreases with age. So it's a childhood nystagmus. It decreases with age. Okay. Then the third type of the childhood nystagmus is your spasmus Newton's syndrome. So this is again a childhood nystagmus by the name of spasmus Newton's. Okay. It is relatively rare. It is not that common. Okay. Now this has a triad. This has a triad of torticollis, a typical head posture, head oscillation, that is the movement of the head is also there, which can be in the form of nodding movement or the lateral movement. Any of these can be present, and nystagmus. Okay. And nystagmus. The nystagmus is your pendular type. Pendular type of nystagmus, equal velocity in both the directions. Okay, so spasmus Newton's classically has a triad of torticollis, head oscillation, head movement, and a pendular type of nystagmus. Pendular type of nystagmus. Okay, now the thing to be remembered about this type of nystagmus is it is seen in infancy, but there is spontaneous resolution. So 2 to 8 years, it spontaneously resolves. Okay. But when you see it in a child, so one has to rule out any CNS lesion. But most of the time, it undergoes spontaneous resolution within 8 years of age. Okay. So this is your spasmus Newton's syndrome. So three type of the childhood nystagmus we have discussed: infantile nystagmus syndrome, latent manifest nystagmus, and the third one, your spasmus Newton's syndrome. Now we come to the second part, which is your again acquired nystagmus, usually seen in adult life. In adult life, acquired nystagmus. Now most of these are characterized by the nature of the nystagmus, in which direction the movement is, and they have their particular causes. So first of all, we will talk about upbeat nystagmus. So as the name is suggesting, upbeat means it is a vertical nystagmus. Okay. And the fast phase is upward. Okay. The fast phase is upward. This is to be remembered. What is the cause? Now, if the nystagmus is present in primary gaze, then it is usually a cerebellar or brainstem lesion. Upbeat nystagmus, if present in primary gaze, okay, so then the cause is cerebellar or brainstem lesion. But if it is present only in up gaze, that when the patient is looking up only, then the nystagmus comes, then you suspect phenytoin toxicity. This type of picture is seen in phenytoin toxicity. So up P, up gaze P, phenytoin. Okay, so you can remember with this. Upbeat nystagmus, either due to cerebellar or brainstem lesion when it is present in primary gaze. If it is present only in up gaze, think of phenytoin toxicity. Then is your downbeat nystagmus. So as the name is suggesting, again a vertical nystagmus, but here the fast phase is downward, as the name is suggesting. Now here the most important cause is your Arnold-Chiari malformation. Okay, so downbeat nystagmus, do remember Arnold-Chiari malformation. Okay, so mostly the posterior fossa disease it is, and that will present as downbeat nystagmus. Then there are certain nystagmus in the particular gazes. One is your gaze evoked nystagmus. Now look at the name, gaze evoked. Evoked means when the person looks in a particular gaze, only then the nystagmus is coming. That is gaze evoked by that particular gaze. So if it is supposedly in the lateral gaze, so if the patient is looking in lateral gaze, then the nystagmus will come. Jerk type of nystagmus with fast component in direction of gaze. So in the direction of the gaze. Okay. So this is seen in brainstem lesions again, or by the CNS depressant drugs, for example, alcohol, barbiturates, etc. Okay. Barbiturates, etc. Then is your gaze paretic. Gaze paretic. So go by the name. Gaze paretic means you ask the patient to look in one gaze, but the eye comes back by a jerk nystagmus to the eccentric fixation. Okay. So this is that there the person has eccentric fixation. Okay. You ask the patient to change the gaze, the eye comes back. So that is gaze paretic. That patient cannot hold in that gaze. The eye will come back. Paretic. You ask the patient to look in that direction, patient cannot hold, the eye comes back. That is gaze paretic. In gaze evoked, you ask the patient to look in that gaze, the nystagmus starts. Nystagmus starts. It is in the same direction of the gaze. Okay. So here it will be opposite. The jerk nystagmus will be towards the eccentric fixation. This is seen in cerebellar lesions. So upbeat nystagmus or gaze paretic nystagmus in cerebellar lesions. Okay. Fine. Moving to few more types of acquired nystagmus. One is your seesaw nystagmus of Madox. Now, this is a very interesting type of the movement of the eyeball. In this, what happens? This is disconjugate movement. So this is an example of disconjugate nystagmus in which the two eyeballs are moving in different directions. So here what happens, the one eyeball goes up and intorts, okay? The other eyeball goes down and extorts. So like a seesaw, one goes up, intort, other goes down, extort, okay? And then after a few cycles, it changes. So a very disturbing situation for the patient. It has lot of oscillopsia. You can imagine these patients have lot of oscillopsia. And this is characteristic of parachiasmal disease. Parachiasmal disease. Please remember, parachiasmal associated with seesaw nystagmus. Okay. Then there is one known as a rebound nystagmus. So rebound again go by the name. In this what happens? It is a like gaze evoked that the, if you ask the patient to look in one gaze, the nystagmus starts. But then due to fatigue of the muscles, due to fatigue of nystagmus in that, it changes its directions. Okay. So that is the difference from the gaze evoked. In gaze evoked, it will remain in the direction of the gaze. But in rebound nystagmus, due to fatigue, it changes its direction. That is your rebound nystagmus. Okay. Then there is a miner's nystagmus, which is seen in the people who work in coal mines, mostly in olden days when there were poor illumination in the coal mines. So these patients used to develop rotatory nystagmus because of the, they had to work long hours in dim light, and that used to lead to the fixation problem. So coal miner's nystagmus is a rotatory type of nystagmus. Then there is ataxic nystagmus, which we see in the cases of internuclear ophthalmoplegia, INO, which is seen in the cases of MLF lesions, medial longitudinal fasciculus lesions. So if we remember what happens in INO, the adducting eye is not able to adduct. Adduction is minus, and the eye which is abducting the other eye, that goes into nystagmus. So this type of the nystagmus is also known as ataxic nystagmus. Okay. Then coming to the last part of the types of nystagmus. So I know you must be a little bit overwhelmed by so many, but if you'll just go through them once more, the things will be very, very clear again. Okay. So there are two conditions, okay, which are very typical. One is your nystagmus blockage syndrome. Always try to find the thing to be remembered by the name, nystagmus blockage. So in this, what happens whenever the eye adducts, the nystagmus decreases. Okay, whenever the eye adducts, there is blockage of the nystagmus. Nystagmus decreases or disappears. So it is inversely proportional to adduction. More the eyes they adduct, nystagmus decreases. If the eyes abduct, nystagmus increases. So what happens? This is again a nystagmus of the childhood. The child develops esotropia. The child develops esotropia because in that gaze, the nystagmus is minimal. Okay. So nystagmus blockage syndrome is one of the DDs of the congenital esotropia, because these children may be actually a case of nystagmus blockage syndrome. Okay. Then is your convergence retraction nystagmus. Now, this type of the condition is actually not a true nystagmus. What is happening here? This starts when you ask the patient to look up. You are asking the patient to look up. But when the patient is trying up gaze, the eyes, they adduct, both the medial recti, they contract, and due to the co-contraction of the muscles, the upward gaze and the contraction of the medial rectus muscle leads to retraction of the globe. It leads to retraction of the globe. Okay. So with convergence, we see that there is retraction. So that is why the name convergence retraction nystagmus. Ask the patient to look up, the eyes will converge and the globe retracts back. Okay. So this is typical of pineal body lesions, pineal tumors, can also be seen with stroke, trauma or multiple sclerosis. Okay, but characteristically seen with the pineal tumors, right? Convergence, retraction, nystagmus. Okay, then just to know that there are few terminologies which are used and they are the differential diagnosis of nystagmus. One is what is known as ocular bobbing. Now, why they are not nystagmus, these three conditions, ocular bobbing, opsoclonus or oculopalatal myoclonus? Because they do not fit the criteria of nystagmus. They are not regular oscillatory movements, rhythmic movements. They are non-rhythmic. So that is why they are not nystagmus. Okay. They are nystagmoid movements. Okay. So one is your ocular bobbing. This is usually seen in pontine lesions in comatose patients. Okay. The movements, irregular movements of the eyeball. Then there is a condition known as opsoclonus, in which again there is a movement of the eyeballs, but there is also associated movement of the limbs, arms or the legs. So usually this happens in cases of encephalitis. Then is your oculopalatal myoclonus. In this, there is movement of the facial muscles also. Eyeball movements along with facial muscle movements. So this is seen in the cases of brainstem lesions. So these are not nystagmus. These are nystagmoid movements because they are not rhythmic. They are not regular. Okay. Right. Okay. So we have covered all the types of nystagmus. And now it is the time to revise with the help of few MCQs. Do let me know your answers in the chat. Okay. So let's start with the first one. Let's start with the first one. Right. So downbeat nystagmus. Downbeat nystagmus is a feature of which type of the lesion? Cerebellar lesion, Arnold Carey nystagmus, Arnold Carey lesion, pontine lesion or optic neuritis? Downbeat nystagmus. Downbeat nystagmus, friends, is associated with Arnold Carey malformation. Okay. Arnold Carey malformation, cervicomedullary lesions are the cause for downbeat nystagmus. Yes, Dr. Jeeva, you are very right. Going next, nystagmus seen in internuclear ophthalmoplegia. Nystagmus seen in internuclear ophthalmoplegia is your seesaw nystagmus, ataxic nystagmus, spasmin nutans, latent nystagmus. Nystagmus seen in internuclear ophthalmoplegia, which is a lesion of MLF. Which type of nystagmus? Yes, very good. Very good once again. Ataxic nystagmus. Okay. Okay. Which type of nystagmus disappears on convergence? Which type of nystagmus disappears on convergence? Nystagmus blockage syndrome, ataxic nystagmus, convergence retraction syndrome, latent nystagmus. Which type disappears on convergence? Remember what I told you. Yes, very good. Very good, Dr. Jeeva. Very good, Dr. Puneet. Nystagmus blockage. Okay. Disappear means it is getting blocked. So, nystagmus getting blocked on convergence is seen in the cases of nystagmus blockage syndrome. And these children, they develop esotropia. They maintain their eyes in adducted position. They develop bilateral esotropia, maintaining their eyes in adducted position. Okay. Right. Perfect. Coming to the last question, which type of nystagmus may spontaneously resolve? Which type of nystagmus may spontaneously resolve? Seesaw nystagmus, ataxic nystagmus, spasmin nutans, downbeat nystagmus. Merry Christmas, a very, very healthy, happy, successful days ahead for all of you. Yes, very, very good. Very good, Dr. Jeeva. It is your spasmins nutans. It is a type of childhood nystagmus as we discussed. Typical triad of head movement, head nodding or lateral movement, torticollis and nystagmus, pandular type of nystagmus, and normally it disappears between 2 to 8 years of age. Okay, so very well. So nystagmus, as you must have realized now, it is not a difficult or confusing topic. It's a very straightforward topic. Yes, you need to remember few points. Okay, so just we have tried to highlight each important point for the particular type of nystagmus. So just go through it once and I'm sure you are done forever. Okay, so my best wishes are with you. Okay, Dr. Jeeva, that's a very good suggestion. Yes, I will for the same. That will be a good thing. Right. So my next YouTube session is going to be on the diseases of the pupil. Okay, we'll be discussing the pupil normal and the diseases. Okay, so I'll be posting it on the Unacademy group. And there are two special classes coming up this weekend. One is about your corneal ulcers on Saturday, that is tomorrow from 5 p.m. onwards. And on Sunday, we have a special class on retinoblastoma again at 5 p.m. So hope to see you there and all the very best friends. Have good learning and a merry Christmas once again.